How about data transfer? Well, once again, when you think about full virtualization, data transfer is implicit. Any data movement that has to happen between the hypervisor and the fully virtualized operating system happens implicitly. In a para-virtualized setting, for example, in Xen, there is an opportunity again to innovate because you can be explicit about the data movement from the guest operating system into the hypervisor and vice versa. There are two aspects to resource management and accountability when it comes to data transfer. The first is the CPU time. So when an interrupt comes in, for instance, from a device, hypervisor has to demultiplex the data that is coming from the device to the domains very quickly upon an interrupt. And there is CPU time involved in making such copies. And the hypervisor has to account for the computation time for managing the buffers on behalf of the virtualized operating system above it. The CPU time accountability is crucial from the point of view of billing in data centers, and therefore hypervisors pay a lot of attention to how CPU time is accounted for and charged to the appropriate virtual machines. The second aspect of the data transfer is how the memory buffers are managed. This is a space issue. The first is a time issue, CPU time issue. The second is a space issue, meaning how are the memory buffers allocated and how are they managed either by the guest operating system or by the hypervisor. As I said, in the context of full virtualization, there is very little scope for innovation. But in the context of para-virtualization, there's a lot of scope for innovation in the way memory buffers are handled between the guest operating system and the hypervisor. Specifically looking at Xen as an instance of para-virtualization, let's look at the opportunities for innovation in the guest OS to Xen communication. Xen provides asynchronous I/O rings, which is basically a data structure that is shared between the guest and the Xen for communication. Any number of these data structures, that is, any number of these I/O rings, can be allocated for handling all the device I/O needs of a particular guest domain. The I/O ring itself is just a set of descriptors. What you see here, they're all descriptors that are available in this data structure. And it's a ring data structure, and that's why it's called I/O ring. And we'll talk about how it is used in a minute. The idea is requests from the guest can be placed in this I/O ring by populating these descriptors. Every descriptor is a unique I/O request coming from the guest operating system. So every request is going to have a unique ID associated with that particular request coming from that guest operating system. And recall what I said earlier, that is, the I/O ring is specific to a guest. So every guest can declare a set of I/O rings as data structures for its communication with Xen. Now, in responding to the request from the guest, Xen, after it completes processing the request, it'll place a response back in the same I/O ring in one of these descriptors, and that response is going to have the same unique ID that was used to communicate the request in the first place. So it's sort of a symmetric relationship between the guest and Xen in terms of request and response for things that the guest wants Xen to get done on its behalf and for Xen to communicate back to the guest that it has completed whatever was requested of Xen. So the guest is the producer of requests. So it has a pointer into this data structure that says where it has to place the next request. So this is a pointer that is manipulated, meaning modified, by the guest, but it is readable by Xen. So there's only one guy that can modify, that is a guest, but Xen can look at this pointer. It's a shared pointer in that sense. For example, the guest operating system may have placed new requests, and that's why it has moved its pointer to here, indicating that it has placed new requests. This is the next empty spot where it can place new requests after these two requests. The consumer for the request produced by the guest operating system is, of course, Xen. And it is processing requests in the order in which they've been produced by the guest operating system. And therefore, it has a pointer into this I/O ring data structure saying where exactly it is presently servicing requests from this guest operating system. So right now, the pointer is pointing here, indicating that Xen is yet to process these two requests that have been queued by the producer, meaning the guest operating system, into this IO ring data structure. So this pointer that the request consumer has is private to Xen. It is just telling Xen where it is in processing requests from the producer. And the difference between these two pointers is telling how many requests are outstanding so far as Xen is concerned in terms of processing requests emanating from the guest. Similar to request production, Xen is going to be the guy that is authoring responses back to the guest operating system. So Xen is the response producer. So it's going to have a pointer where it can place new responses. So once again, this pointer is a shared pointer, updated by Xen, but can be read by the guest. So these are two new responses that Xen has placed in the I/O ring in response to requests that it has already processed. But these responses have not yet been picked up by the producer. The guest operating system has a pointer that says where it is in this I/O ring data structure in terms of picking up the responses coming from Xen. Xen has produced these two new responses as a result of processing some prior requests from the guest operating system, but the guest operating system is yet to process these requests. So this pointer is private to the guest operating system that is telling it where it is in processing responses coming back from Xen. The difference between this pointer and this pointer is the number of responses that are yet to be picked up by the guest operating system. Just to recap, the difference between these two pointers is the number of requests that are yet to be processed by Xen, and the difference between these two pointers is the number of responses that are yet to be picked up by the guest. And these slots are the empty slots into which new requests can be placed by the request producer. The request producer moves like this, and the response taker moves like this, and the response producer moves like this, and the request consumer moves like this. And these are the empty slots into which Xen can place additional responses as it processes more requests from the guest operating system. That's the idea behind this I/O ring data structure, very powerful abstraction that allows the guest to place requests asynchronously and for Xen to place responses asynchronously into this data structure. As I mentioned already, the guest can identify the request for which a particular response is intended because the ID that is associated with the response is going to be exactly the same as the ID that was associated with the request in the first place. The other thing that we should remember is that these are just descriptors of the requests and responses. Any data that has to be passed from the guest to Xen will just be a pointer from these descriptors to a machine page that the guest owns so that Xen can pick up that data directly from that machine page without any copy. Similarly, if the responses given by Xen is going to have data associated with it, that'll again be a pointer from the descriptor data structure to the machine page that contains the data that Xen wants to pass up to the guest. In other words, this asynchronous I/O rings is a powerful mechanism both for efficient communication between the guest and Xen and for also avoiding copying overhead between the paravirtualized guest operating system and Xen, which is the virtualization layer. We will look at two specific examples on how these I/O rings are used for guest and Xen communication.